Welcome to our Halloween episode. I'm Kate Conroy.
Ooh, I'm Vinnie Sotelo.
And this is Other People's Business, which is a podcast from the New Jersey Business and Industry Association. We started the pod because we wanted you to be able to get to know our membership and us a little better and maybe even learn something new along the way.
So today's guest is Jodi Grinwald of Today is the Day. Jodi, say hi, introduce yourself.
Hi, yes, I'm Jodi Grinwald. I am with Today is the Day Coaching, Consulting, and Leadership Development. I am thrilled to be here. Thank you both for having me.
Always.
Absolutely. And by the way, big props to Jodi. She's on the committee that drives the Women Business Leaders Forum, which is the event Women Business Leaders Forum, which is an event that we just had last month back in September. And Jodi was instrumental in making that event really successful. And we thank you. Big props.
Yes, thank you very
much. Thank you.
Oh, I'm so happy to be working with you guys. You have an amazing organization.
Thank you. So we're going to get started with an icebreaker. Are you a beach person or a mountains person?
I am absolutely a beach person.
Really?
Yes, absolutely.
That is, tell us why.
Sure. So years and years ago, feels like another lifetime ago, as a teenager, I lived on the beach at Monmouth Beach for a little while, and I just felt a huge connection there. But mostly because when I'm there, I just feel like I'm connected to the world. I can't even explain it. It just is a moment of connection, which I'm sure we'll talk about in a little bit, because the beach has a really mm-hmm. big meaning to me.
Oh, excellent. Vin.
Oh, wow. I mean, do we have mountains in New Jersey? I'm going to feel really dumb if we do, but we have beaches here.
Oh, we do.
Many episodes ago, I don't know, we learned that I'm an inside person.
Yes.
So, I mean, I'm not a frequent at either one, but if I had to pick one, it would definitely be the beach. I love the ocean. As a swimmer, I actually really love the waves. If I could do it like indoors in a wave pool, that's really cool. But either way, I mean, I love going swimming in the waves and everything.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So I am actually a beach person as well, but I do not go in the water.
Ah.
I am a little freaked out by what is in the water. And
oh, sure.
I grew up, you know, in Minnesota, tons of lakes and rivers, and I was always very aware, and my family is full of hunters and fishermen. I was always very aware of all of the fish that had, you know, really big teeth.
Or jellyfish or something.
So when I first moved to New Jersey, first trip, I was 20 years old, went to the beach with the family I was staying with. And, you know, I'm splashing around in the ocean, Spring Lake we were at, and I was just loving life. And this woman who's like 10 feet away from me, kind of further out from the, and I'm literally like waist deep water. It was not deep at all. She turns around to me and she's like, "Hey, you know, just be careful. There's a jellyfish right there next to." And I was like, "Are you kidding me?" And I did the quickest about face in water that you have ever seen in your life, and I marched back to the shore, and that was it for me. I'm done with the water.
I wonder how she saw it from 10 feet.
I don't know.
We're not in like Oahu, where like
you know,
the crystal clear blue water. You can see every little pebble. You know.
So secretly,
this is New Jersey.
That's always freaked me out the most, because how big did that jellyfish have to be for her to see it through the water?
The Cthulhu of jellyfish.
I have a rule. If I can't see my feet, I do not go in.
Thank you.
Wow. That's the rule. Yeah.
I love the beach. I do not go in the water.
Mm-hmm. Mm-mm. I'm a shell person, so I love to collect shells. It relaxes me. That's one of my favorite things.
Nice.
I collect them. Now ask me what I do with them once I collect them. I don't really have anything yet, but they're just sitting there waiting for something.
So they have made it home. There's an area.
They always make it home, and I always have a bag to put them in, and then when they get there, that's where they stay.
So tell us about the question, what color is your sky?
Well, that leads right into the beach piece, too, because my father passed away after being diagnosed with ALS.
Oh, my gosh.
Only 6 months after of diagnosis, which was horrible for him. And he's so young. And so we decided, which I will say a disclaimer, that it is is not environmentally friendly, but I did release balloons in his name. And when I looked up at the sky to release them and watch them go up with my family, it felt like it was the very first time I had seen the sky in, I don't know, 20 years, because I worked so hard, so much. I had two kids, and I worked a job that took me, and I was traveling all over the place 60, 80 hours a week. So I wasn't really connected. I was living on what most people call autopilot. Mm-hmm. And so when I looked up, I was like, oh my gosh, I haven't felt this in a long time. The sky looked like a different color. I know it sounds crazy, but it did. It looked like something I hadn't seen in a while. So I decided, you know, we really need to take a moment sometimes to find our connection. So what I did is I started posting pictures of skies, beautiful sky landscapes. And what would happen is people would post theirs on my page, and then I wound up getting pictures from people overseas and all over the world. And what I said is, if you take a picture of the moment you feel a connection, and you hold on to it. When things aren't going great in your world, you re-look at that picture again, you can be brought back to that moment again.
Wow.
And
so, that's beautiful.
That's amazing.
Thank you. So it doesn't have to be a sky. Say if you're sitting in your living room and you're having a great day and everything's good and you're reading a book, take a picture. But remember that it's to bring you back to a feeling. Because a lot of times we're so disconnected.
That's incredible.
Well, thank you.
How does it interact with your day-to-day life, with your consulting business?
You know, because I have private clients and I have business clients, we talk a lot about that, right? So, you know, when business gets crazy and there's a ton of pressure and people are feeling like everything is happening all at once, sometimes you need to take a breather, right? So you can pull up a picture, have something hanging in your office. Try to go back to a time when you felt something where you were connected. Have a conversation with someone about something that makes you feel connected. So it impacts pretty much. And every day when I wake up, I ask myself, what color is your sky today? Because our brains are our internal sky. And it's up to us to make the decision what color our sky is internally. Outside, we have no control. Inside, we do.
Kate, what color is your sky?
I like that. I think it's magenta.
Magenta.
Ooh, I like it.
What about you, Vin?
I like black. I'm a night person. Yeah.
That's right. You have those blackout curtains.
That's right. Yes.
Oh, mysterious.
My gosh. Huh? So mysterious. What about you? What color is your sky today?
My sky would be turquoise.
Ooh.
It's totally turquoise. It's my favorite.
That's awesome. I like that. It reminds me of Tiffany Blue, not to be like
too... Yeah, there you go. Well, yep. What a girl wants, right?
Yeah, not to be too, what's the word, materialistic.
Hmm.
Yeah. All right, so I think on that note, we're going to take a quick break. Be right back. And we're back. Our next question is, in honor of Halloween, if you had to choose whether you were going to be bitten by a vampire or a werewolf, which would you choose and why?
Wow.
And I feel like, Vin, you need to go first because this is something you've been thinking about, right?
Okay, so, All right, so I'm a huge horror movie fan. I'm a huge fan of all movie genres. But, you know, horror has a special place in my heart. I was a big fan as a teen. So do I get to choose the franchise that, like, the rules, because there's a lot of different rules in a lot of different franchises.
Do you want to be a sparkly vampire?
Yes, like, I was just saying, as an example, if I'm in Twilight, like, that's probably the most romanticized of all of them. But, like, almost every single telling of, like, werewolf stories I can think of, like, turning into a werewolf freaking hurts. Like, I don't know if you,
I never thought about that.
American Werewolf in London, that guy, like, transforms into a werewolf for, like, 6 minutes. And I think we're intended to think it was longer than that, like, in his time.
Uh-huh.
And, like, he's just, like, in writhing pain the whole time. And that's pretty much what it is in just about everything I can think of, except for, say, like, Michael J. Fox's Teen Wolf, you know?
Oh, right. You just made me think of Remus Lupin from Harry Potter. It was not easy when he changed
his
Yeah,
none of them are. Plus, okay, so being a werewolf has a lot of other downsides. So, like, you wake up out of this trance, and then, you know, people are dead, and, you know, like people you loved were hurt. You know,
it's like you've entered a fugue state.
Yes. So that's not a good thing.
No.
I mean, I think if I could pick between the two, it would probably be a vampire. I'm an inside person anyway, so I, like, the sun thing is not going to bother me. If I could be Blade, I don't know if you're familiar with Blade.
No.
Blade is the Daywalker, they call him. His mother was bitten while she was giving birth to Blade, and he came out half human, half vampire. They say all of the strengths, none of the weaknesses, except for the thirst. So, like, you're going to have the thirst no matter what. As a vampire, at least I could have all the strengths without, you know, I could still walk out in the sun.
Sure.
Blade would be awesome. But I think even if I couldn't be Blade, vampires would probably be better than werewolves.
Yeah. I think you talked me into it. I don't know. Jodi,
I'm in with him 100%. You're in. Absolutely.
All right. So I have to say I agree. And if anybody's watching Preacher this season, Cassidy, I love that he just stocks up from the blood bank, you know, in the fridge. He's got little packets full for the thirst. and then he carries, like, a little parasol or an umbrella or something with him, so the sun thing isn't, like, that big a deal.
I wonder if you could get away with not eating humans, you know?
Right, like, just, you know, like a sippy cup.
Well, does his blood come? Because I'm actually not caught up on Preacher. I think I'm 3 or 4 episodes into the current season. So, like,
awesome.
Does he have blood stockpiled from things that are not humans, or is it human blood?
I think it's human blood. I think they have, like, a connection at the hospital or the morgue. Or
break into some blood banks?
Red Cross? I don't know.
The Red Cross. How awful of a person do I have to be stealing blood from the Red Cross? I don't know what's worse, going out and biting random people or stealing blood from a charity.
Yeah, that's pretty
But we'd
bad.
Prefer the morgue.
We would.
That would be the best way, right?
That would definitely be the best
way. Oh, my God.
I can't even believe we just went there.
I know.
Yeah. No, I'm thinking about that, because then I'm like, if they're dead already, I mean, does that count? Because, like, things happen to your blood after you die, right? Like,
maybe you have,
I don't
like,
know.
A little bit of time.
Because I feel like, I feel like if vampires could be eating people or biting people who are already dead, then
that
they'd have just
the
been
problem.
Doing that anyway.
Right.
Yeah, like,
good call. So it would have to be somebody that's alive.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay, so change of subject quickly. Are you guys watching the Santa Clarita Diet?
Oh my God, that's one of my favorite shows.
Me too! Yes. Oh, so I'm thinking about her, like, having a freezer full of body parts and then just making a little slushy for, you know, the road.
It's a Netflix original series. Drew Barrymore plays somebody who just randomly becomes a zombie one day.
Yeah.
And it's not, wow, how do you say this? Like, it's not like the kind of zombie that, you know,
right.
But like, she's just a normal functioning person, but then she goes into like, I have to eat brains modes.
Right.
And it's just the funny thing about the husband, they have this,
love
like,
him.
Such a normal relationship.
Yes.
And it just like pulls at him so much, like mentally taxes him that like, his wife is out there eating people, and he's like breaking psychologically.
He's trying so hard to be supportive, and it's just hurting him so badly.
Yeah.
What is his name? He was the hot guy from Justified.
I Raylan think of him, Gibbons. This is going to be a spoiler. He was the killer in Scream 2.
And he was on Deadwood as the sheriff.
I'm sorry, I can't think of his name.
Whoever you are, sorry, you're hot, but we can't.
I'll throw the same compliment to Drew Barrymore.
Agreed. And she has great hair in that show. Oh my gosh, I watched that show almost just for the hair envy.
Sure.
It's great.
I often sit around thinking, if only I could have Drew Barrymore's hair.
I mean, I do. All right. Sorry. We should probably get back to business.
Sure. So today is the day. Tell me how you started the company.
Sure. So I spent a long time in development, financial development for nonprofit organizations, and which was fabulous. I love that work. But one day at one of my, I had a women's breakfast, and I invited a coach to come out and speak. And I had no idea what a coach even was. And when she spoke, it was the weirdest thing that happened. It was snowing outside. We never thought she was actually going to be able to make it to the event. And she was, her mentor had passed away. So the day before, so we didn't even know she'd be able to come, and she did. Of course, I was sweating it out, hoping that she would make it.
Wow.
And we had all these female executives there. And as she's speaking, I swear I can't make this up, sunlight came across her face, and it's snowing, and I'm in the back of the room, and I'm watching her take everybody on this journey as she's making them cry, she's making them laugh, but they all left feeling inspired. And for a while, I had felt like I didn't really know what I wanted. Like, I was in love with my job, but let me say I loved my job, but I wasn't in love with it. I knew something was missing. So I was like, what is this all about? I left. And I went and I looked up what is it all. And coaching is kind of like such a generic term. Really, I'm there to help people get from where they are to where they want to be. Same thing with businesses. And so with that being said, I went and I figured, well, wait a second, I have a full-time job. I can't go back to school right now. It's just too crazy. I have two kids, one heading off to high school, the other one soon. I'm sorry, one heading off to high school and the other one heading off to college soon. So it was going to be even more crazy. Plus, I need to take a loan, and I didn't want to do that right before I had kids heading off to college.
Yeah.
So I didn't do it. 2 years went by, my father got diagnosed with ALS, and one of the things he always wanted to do was to be a singer. He was an opera singer, actually, but he worked in Manhattan.
Wow.
And yes, my youngest takes after him. She's an opera singer. She's 15 also.
Neat.
And yeah, it's really cool. And so what happened was is that he kept talking about giving up his dream, because he had a family and he had things he needed to take care of. And I promised him that before he passed that I would go and back to school and do what I knew I wanted to do with my life. And but the thing was nothing changed. I still had the full-time job, I still had the children, and I still had no money to do it with, because I didn't want to take it from what I'd be doing for my children. But 2 months of the day he passed was my first day of my first class. Because, what happened was is that my why totally changed, and I forgot about how I was going to make it happen. I wound up being more accountable to what I promised my dad as opposed to being accountable to myself.
Sure.
And so many of us, all the time we do that, right? We know what we want, but we're afraid to go there because it's scary. Nothing changed. My circumstances were the same. The only thing was the difference was why, because I made a promise to someone else other than myself. So it was the strangest thing, because of course I wish he could have seen the work I'm doing now and how I am helping people and how wonderful it is to be able to work with these amazing clients who put their faith in me to help them with their journey. But, you know, the thing about it is that one of the things I taught everywhere I go, whenever I give a talk, because I'm also a keynote speaker and I go out and I do workshops and I teach at Ocean County College and Mercer County College continuing education classes. I tell the story all the time. It's really not about how you're going to get there. It's why you want to get there. And that will push you to really get to where you want to be. It sounds simple.
That's amazing.
But it's really not. It just unfortunately, it should never have to take a tragic event in your life to get you to where you want to go.
But I love the way you just change the conversation ever so slightly, and suddenly things become super clear.
I do. And it's amazing how that happens. So now with the people I'm working with, that's what we talk about, because like we all start out with, I wish I could.
Right.
Okay, why can't you? Like, really, what is a real reason? Money. Okay, well, I had the money issue too, right? So I can speak from experience. I can't fix everyone's, but I can speak from experience, and we can talk through it and get rid of some of those gremlins, which is what we call those fears, as they come up, and really talk to people and, you know, even about their companies and how to work through them. Because it's every day is, you know, it's scary when you're not sure what the end result is going to be.
Yeah.
But it's more, you know, what's worse is when you don't do what you want to do and you're in a place where you can't do it anymore. That's even scarier.
Yeah, no kidding.
So I didn't mean to bring the mood down, but I definitely just wanted, I think it's just an important thing for people to know that you can make things that seem impossible happen as long as you continue to take, I say one baby step at a time. It may be not even be a baby step. It's just something, you tweak one little thing. If you don't like where you're working, put your resume together. Mm-hmm. Simple. And then keep going from there. Start sending it to people to have other people look at it and see what's wrong, what you can add. Just one little thing at a time.
I was going to say, you didn't bring the mood down. If anything, you're inspiring, where we were just talking about stealing blood from the Red Cross. That was a much darker place for this podcast to have been.
I totally agree. I was thinking the same thing.
Good. I'm so glad.
Yeah.
I know. Well, you know, when you talk about somebody passing, that's always, but, you know, absolutely, you know, if something good had to come out of it, unfortunately, it's this, but it you know, he's watching wherever he is, and that's the good news, right?
Yeah.
Out of a bad situation.
That's fantastic.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. And it blends right into the What Color Is Your Sky Today piece also. And, you know, getting people to stay connected. And like I said, so many times we just are thinking about how much we have to do. I think if anybody was to ask me, what is something your clients constantly say, whether it's a business issue or it's a personal issue, we don't have enough time.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Yeah. How many people feel like I don't have enough time in the day? But the thing is because a lot of times we're putting unrealistic things on ourselves or on our staff instead of really thinking through, okay, what are things I have to get done today? Not, you know, because the want list gets real long real quick.
Absolutely. I remember it was a couple of years ago. I don't do this at work yet. But in my personal life, I started to feel overwhelmed by all of the things that I was, you know, agreeing to do for other people. Okay. And I started to think, like, what is the worst case scenario for saying yes and then feeling resentful and unhappy? And that made me realize that sometimes saying no is doing that person a favor. And I will couch it if and when I have to say no, I'll say, I don't want to commit to something that I'm not 100% sure that I can give you. Okay. I don't want to disappoint you and I don't want to disappoint myself. So for right now, anyway, the answer is no.
Exactly, because you wouldn't be able to give 100% of, and you wouldn't be 100%. The one thing I would say is if your head and your feet are not in the same place, then you shouldn't be there.
100%. Wow. Deep. Very. Seriously. Before we go to our last question, any last words of wisdom?
I just think that it's important to really look and really be honest with yourself, you know, when you're thinking about the things you do want out of life or what you want to accomplish in a day, and really just make sure that you're being true to your own values. And that's when most people are the most conflicted, is when you're breaking a value that you, you know, that you internally feel very conflicted about. And that's when we feel kind of the most, where we don't feel comfortable.
Yeah.
So, and that's where I feel not so connected. And that's where What Color Is Your Sky comes in, because then you get to kind of go back to a moment when you did feel connected and work things through.
That's amazing. So I think we're going to close out the way we always do. What are you hoping for this week? And we usually go first. One of us will go first to give you time to think about the answer.
Awesome.
So
I'm hoping for a whole train of trick-or-treaters. Halloween is, you know, the alpha and the omega of favorite holidays of mine.
Wow.
And it's just in the last few years, you know, like, I guess other people have just not been into it in the same way I am. But, like, you know, last year I was in costume all night. I got a horror movie. I was watching Scout's Guide to the Zombie Apocalypse.
Wait, what were you in costume as?
A giant penguin. So, like, if you remember, if you remember last year, we did a video with my good friend Nicola.
Yes.
And we put her in my Halloween costume, and she did stats about, like, Halloween.
I remember.
So that was my Halloween costume that year.
Didn't
we just brought that into the office, and she put it on. But
that's
yeah.
Outstanding.
So I don't know what I'm going to be yet this year. I guess I've got like one day to figure it out, but I'm great at that. No, but yeah, I'll be in costume, I'll be watching movies, and I'll have a ton of candy, and hopefully the door rings more than like one or two times, because last year was a real disappointment.
Do you have a favorite Halloween movie?
Ooh, that's a great question. So I love A Nightmare on Elm Street. I don't know if you ever, the original one before they started making Freddy scary.
I think you know how I feel about scary movies.
Even Hellboy. What was it like many episodes ago?
I can't do it.
She was watching a movie that wasn't even scary and she was terrified.
Totally terrified.
Yeah, I think A Nightmare on Elm Street is probably it. I also love the funnier of the Jason movies, like Jason X, where he goes into space. It's
That's
hilarious.
A thing? The Jason movies get funny?
The Jason movies are hilarious. You have to have a really dark sense of humor, but like, definitely. You know, the way he kills people is intended to be funny after a while. Not the first few movies,
gotcha.
But like, they reach a point where like, they're doing the same thing over and over again. Unless they start like, you know, making it funny, it's not going to be interesting anymore.
Right.
Like the Child's Play series with the killer doll, that evolved into just a completely funny series. It's
Chucky.
It's not even trying to be scary anymore. But yeah, like Bride of Chucky is hilarious. You should watch that if you haven't. Oh my God. It's a total take on marriage and like it's seen through the eyes of these psychotic dolls. It's hilarious.
I've heard this before where people think that these horror movies are funny and I won't sleep for 3 days.
Me too!
Well, no, like the ones that are intended to be scary are not funny.
Right. Okay, okay.
But there are ones that are just trying to be funny because they realize that a lot of people aren't scared by these things anymore.
Wow.
Real life is much more terrifying than a Child's Play movie.
Dream.
Yes, Requiem for a Dream.
Oh my God. All right, Jodi, what's your hope for the week?
Well, I'm hoping my daughter comes in because there's a drive-in movie for Halloween in our town. So, and our favorite movie, because my kids loved it when they were little, Hocus Pocus.
Movie,
and so they grew up watching that. So we have a drive-in movie with that movie playing locally. And so I'm hoping that my daughter will come in from college so that the three of us, me and my two daughters, can go see it.
That sounds awesome.
That's amazing.
It should be fun.
I love it.
No.
Drive-ins are a real treat these days.
I agree.
I saw my first drive-in movie, I want to say like a year and a half ago or so.
Really?
Might be a little bit longer, but like somewhere recently. It was Vacation, like the remake with the guy from The Office.
Yes.
And they did a double header, and the one after that was Jurassic World, which is really weird because those two movies are nothing alike and nothing combined. But like we watched it. It was really cool.
That's awesome.
I haven't been into a drive-in. I don't want to say my age, so I won't say for how long, but it's been a long time, and they were going out of there when I was younger.
Yeah,
there was
a couple.
Very few then.
Yeah.
So.
Interesting.
I'm excited.
It has been forever. That's awesome. So my hope is actually the exact opposite of your hope, Vin. I never get a lot of trick-or-treaters down my street. And I always buy a ton of candy, and then I'm always left with all this candy that I can just, you know, eat.
Oh, so you don't want the trick-or-treaters to show up.
You know, it's not terrible if they show up, but would I be happy to just stockpile all that candy and then slowly eat my way to Christmas?
Probably all
right. With that, yeah. And you inspired me. I think we're going to watch Shaun of the Dead this
Shaun
movie.
Of the Dead is a good one.
Love it.
Have you seen Shaun of the Dead?
No, I feel very lame here with Hocus Pocus.
Hocus Pocus is an awesome
movie. That's a great movie. Great movie.
That's actually a favorite in our household. My wife, Tara, has to watch it every year.
Mm-hmm.
So Shaun of the Dead is one of those ones that's really funny for a while there, but you hit a point where they stop trying to be funny and they go serious. Yeah, like the last 15-20 minutes of that movie are terrifying.
Yeah, it really is. But then it ends great. Well, sort of. For most everybody, it does.
Oh, man. I'm remembering everybody getting torn apart. I don't remember the great ending at the end, but...
Should I spoil it? I mean, it's been out a long
time. I'm just spoiling the fact that people are getting torn apart here. But
So the best friend ends up a zombie locked in the garden shed, just playing video games as a zombie for the rest of his life. And, you know, every morning...
And then you'd be immortal. You get to play video games forever. I like that.
I mean, Sean, you know, wakes up. The last scene in the movie is Sean waking up. His girlfriend is making breakfast in the kitchen. And it's like they're having this little lovely life together. And then he's like, okay, I'll be right back. And she's like, okay. And he goes out the back door into the garden shed. And the best friend, I can never think of his name. Nick Frost, I think, is the name of the actor. Mm. And he's like, you know, he's like a zombie chained to the wall. And Sean hands him breakfast and he's like, you know, eating. Huh? I sound like the hog is ridiculous, I know.
Oh, sure. No. Hey, it's a zombie movie thing. You know?
It is so hilarious. But then, like, the movie ends the way that the movie opened, with them on a couch in front of the TV playing video games
That's
together.
That's awesome.
It really is.
I don't know why. It's like been 15, 20 years since. When did that come out?
I have no idea.
I want to say turn of the century.
Turn of the century.
Like 2001, 2004, somewhere in there.
Something like that. Yeah. I love that movie.
Huh?
Totally going to watch that.
All right, so I guess that's our show.
I think it is. Thanks so much for listening. Please subscribe.
So we're on iTunes, we're on Google Play, anywhere where you can get a podcast, we're there. We hope that you would subscribe. We hope that you'll rate us. So if you love the show, please give us the max rating you can. I think it's like 5 stars on
iTunes.
It would really help us with discoverability and everything.
Definitely. And thank you to our early subscribers. We really appreciate all the buzz out there. You're sharing the love, and we appreciate it. Thank you, Jodi, for joining us today. Jodi Grinwald from Today is the Day, and What Color is Your Sky Today?
Yeah, thank you for being
here. No problem. And you can find both of those on Facebook, at What Color is Your Sky Today on Facebook, and Instagram, Your Sky Color.
Fabulous. All right. Have a great Halloween,
everybody. Happy Halloween.
Bye.
Bye.